with the beats, with the rhymes, whatever. We'll be right back. streets with the rhymes with the...
Thank you. producer up. Mr. Producer up.
Hey guys, student producer Michel Gross with another hidden gem K. What is the relationship between stress, cats, and coffee? Studies show that interacting with cats can reduce stress, anxiety, and potentially helps you sleep better. What if you don't have someone like Hector? No problem, because Katie McHugh formulated an idea to create Sip and Purr, the first coffee bar with cats in the Midwest. Sip and Purr is designed for everyone, cat lovers and cat enthusiasts, especially ones who want to experience what it is like to interact with cats. You can get into the enclosed area or watch through the window while you get tea, coffee, or a cat-themed cocktail. Like this one, this is a Moscow Mule. These beauties will join you as you sip or eat. They have traveled from as far as Qatar, and all the others come from Lakeland Animal Shelter in Wisconsin, where they have lived in an open cat colony, which makes them very, very friendly. Your connection with them may grow as you cuddle, sip, and eat with your new feline friend. You may fall in so much love with them that you will be aching to take them home. This has been another Hidden Gem K.
Combining creative and practical aspects of sound and music inside the music department, student producers Gabrielle and Michael show the practical knowledge gained at the audio program here at MATC. Let's check it out.
Audio production has become more affordable as technology advances. The technique and knowledge taught in MATC's audio production program is timeless. Jim Reith, instructor of MATC's audio program, crafted the program after years of working in the industry.
I got into this stuff first because I was in the industry. For years I'd written music for music advertising, original music for advertising. Before that I worked as a teacher, and I was teaching music. So I was asked to teach a course called Music Appreciation as a part-time instructor, and I noticed they only had two classes in the audio program. And so I did some studying and I built the rest of the programs, and since then it's been a wonderful program that's blossomed.
Audio production student Ethan Pabst enjoys putting what he learns from MATC to practical use in the real world.
Really, when it comes to like routing within digital audio workstations and even the more physical aspects when working with like physical mixing equipment, I've learned a lot about how to properly route sound to get the best results, and I've been able to use that in a lot of different circumstances outside of class. Equipment here and the faculty have lots of real world experience, and I think that they do a good job of explaining concepts that we can expect to see when we decide to go out into the industry.
Skills acquired during a student's time at MATC's audio production program lines up with other similar programs in the area, but there's one big difference.
you see, have the same kind of instructors here that have more than 10 years of experience, and you have the same kind of gear here, $100,000 SSL console and all the outboard gear and microphone selections like a U87, a $3,600 microphone. All of that is here, but it's cheaper. That's what actually makes it different. You can go four semesters and spend $8,000 to $10,000 and you'll have completed the program, as compared to some other schools it might be $40,000 to $60,000. Every student is going to be really proficient in two different softwares, Pro Tools and Logic. They're going to have a strong idea of microphone selection and placement, what instruments, how to put them, how to get the best sound. They'll know signal flow. How do you plug stuff in? And you put that all together and they'll be able to mix using different signal processes like equalization, compression, reverbs. All the classes are using a lot of those things. It's really important that they get a skill set to serve those purposes.
I feel like, especially when it comes down to mixing, we do quite a lot of that. A lot of times it can be rather time consuming. You need a lot of patience when sitting down working with audio. And we also have a lot of interdepartmental projects that we do. One that I can think of is we work with the music department. We record a live concert, and there's a lot of coordination that needs to take place in that. But it is, you know, it is sometimes a challenge, but it is also a lot of fun to do. Speaking from my own experience, because I have kind of worked in this sort of bedroom studio sort of thing for quite a while now, and I can just tell, even after being in the program working with more expensive equipment, that I can translate a lot of those skills that I learned here and find things that I might not have done before when working on my own projects at home. And I feel like that's helping me make better songs, making them sound better, and just being more creative and able to experiment with things.
There's many, many opportunities out there that we introduce our students to where they can make a comfortable living.
I feel like I just have those tools that'll help me be successful in really whatever I decide to go out and do.
A good program for students to have, all while being productive.
Speaking of counselors and registration, student producer Spencer Tate gives us more insight on guided pathways.
Guided Pathways was created to help students graduate from point A to point B. Any academic or non-academic needs the students need, their Guided Pathway program would be like their home base. My name is Sausan Kadada. I'm a Student Success Liaison for the Creative Arts and Media Design Pathway. I've been here for about 1 year and really excited about my role. So a Student Success Liaison is the first point of contact for students when they walk into our pathway department. We ask them questions about what their issues are, what help they're looking to get. And from there, we kind of assess the situation, maybe have them see a retention coach, an academic advisor, or maybe their needs are in different departments. We make sure that they get there. So we're in room C210. Students can come in for studying if they want to, but really to help with registration or non-academic needs. It's a really nice open area where our retention coaches and academic advisors are. My favorite part about working with students is knowing that I help them. When they walk out the door and they say thank you, I had no idea what I was doing before, or I asked for different offices and I just kept getting the runaround. When they leave with a little bit of help and gratitude, that is the best feeling in the world.
Well, that was very informative, and it is important that we familiarize ourselves with guided pathways.
Thanks, Bert. Now that it's starting to get colder out, I'm sure a lot more people would enjoy going to the Pettit Center for open skating. Right now, I'm with student producer Austin Diaz's mother, Monica. Nice to meet you. How are you doing today?
Good. I'm good. How are you, Sydney?
I'm doing great. What are we going to make today?
Today we're making chicken enchiladas.
Oh, that sounds really good.
Yep. Great, nice, warm meal for this cold night like today.
Yeah, perfect for the weather. Mm-hmm. So what do we do to get started?
Okay, so in this pan, I already sauteed about a cup of onions and about 2 teaspoons of oil.
Okay.
Just until they're nice and translucent like this, so I'm going to go ahead and turn that off.
Got it.
And in this pan, this is the sauce. All it is a can of cream of chicken soup.
Okay.
Along with 8 ounces of sour cream. And I'm going to add 1/8 teaspoon of cumin and about 1 teaspoon of coriander.
Perfect.
And again, that just heats up until it's a little bit warm, doesn't have to be boiling, and that's it.
Right.
Okay, and all now right. to this pan, I'm gonna go ahead and pull it off the heat. This is about 2 cups of shredded chicken. I just took a rotisserie chicken, got it from.
Yeah, you know. Then you don't have to cook and
exactly.
worry about it.
Exactly, and this is about a half of one, so you can eat the other half or make sandwiches out of it. Easy, easy. And then I'm also gonna add 4 ounces of chopped green chilies for a little bit of spice.
Mm-hmm. All right. Okay. I'm not too much about spice in my food, mm-hmm. but it won't be too much, right?
Very mild, it's very mild. If you could hand me the cheese.
Yes, I can.
This is just good old shredded cheddar. I'm gonna add about a half a cup. Again, you don't have to measure. I have a total of about 1.5 cups here.
All right.
And again, about a half a cup of the sauce.
Okay.
Again, no need to measure.
I'm not all about measuring. I'm not either.
And while this is getting mixed up, if you could grab the tortillas out of the microwave. Yeah, Austin asked me to make these, so I think that he's actually just really hungry for this. So now he gets a chance to eat some.
Is it one of his favorite foods?
I think it is. He's always been into these. And I don't mind because it's so easy to make.
Yeah.
So once this is all mixed in, we're going to go ahead and evenly put this on the tortillas.
All right.
And if you could help me roll these up.
Of course I can do that.
This is a little bit messy, but not too, too bad.
Right.
And I've heard rumors that you like to get food on your hands. So.
I don't like to. It just always happens.
Just kind of
that
happens.
Way. Yes.
Yep. And I did spray this pan. So you just use a normal 9x13 pan.
Okay.
So.
And then
most students should have this.
How many normally fit in this pan?
6.
Here?
Perfect. Yep. This makes 6 tortillas.
And is this good for a college budget?
I would say definitely, because the rotisserie chicken you can get for about $5. Can of soup, sour cream, yeah, this is all stuff. And the spices, again, you can adjust those to however your taste is.
Yeah, okay. Seam side down, right?
Seam side down.
So it doesn't
down.
Pop up like
correct.
It just did.
Correct.
Okay.
Is that the end of our tortillas?
Yeah.
Okay.
We're on to that.
So hopefully these are all even.
I mean,
roll that
we
last
can help.
One up. Then you just take your sauce and go ahead and pour that across the top.
Sounds good.
Down there. If you could just sprinkle the rest of the cheese on
yes,
top
I
then.
Can absolutely do that. And then what do you do after that?
And then we just stick it in the oven, 350 degrees for about 25 to 30 minutes. And I'll grab the one that we finished earlier. We have some good cheesy goodness here.
That looks amazing. It's all melted up and
all
everything.
Melted. Right, let me get you.
Thank you.
Hot so I don't burn my hand.
That would be smart. I've done that many times and it's never fun. And then do you just serve it like this or can you put stuff on
it? Yeah, you can serve it if you want to top it. I like mine personally with some jalapenos on it, some chopped green or black olives. Mm-hmm. You can add avocados. You can add salsa. That's how I like it too.
That is super good. Yeah. I've never had a homemade enchilada before. So thank you for sharing this with us. Can I get the recipe?
You sure can.
Wonderful. All right. So that recipe will be posted on the College Today's Facebook page.
Hello, I'm student producer John Carlo Rosilio, and you're watching another Hidden Gem KE. We're here at the Schlitz Audubon Nature Center in Bayside. This 185-acre nature preserve originally started as a forested area inhabited by Native Americans. Today, it's a great place to get away from the noise and stress of everyday life through nature.
The Schlitz has a variety of trails, forests, and wetlands for you to hike through, even a 60-foot tower to see autumn in its true beauty.
Not only does this place have gorgeous scenery, it has birds of prey, too.
This is a great place for kids to get introduced to nature. Even my buddy Skywalker here gets in on the fun.
Birds aren't the only wildlife you'll see here. On the Mystery Boardwalk Trail, you'll see frogs, muskrats, turtles, and more. Well, I think that's it for my day at the forest. I'll be here checking out the best view of Lake Michigan. Anyways, this has been another Hidden Gem KE.
do.
I'm gonna drink until I forget my name.
We are currently very behind because there's a lot of things going wrong. We are missing a guest co-host and a guest, which fill up a lot of time, and they're really good for transitions. So therefore, we have to scramble during the last hour and a half here.
As planned, as well you got it and stuff. We're gonna pretty much see what we have in the script that we can use, trim any of the fat that we can't use, and go live at 10:30. So.
Coming up on MATC Now.
MATC Now is MATC's magazine show, short of showing off the classes, the programs, the people that make MATC great. Everything from events to things going on inside of the college, outside the college, how it benefits the community. Everything we document. The second year students at the TV video program go out, shoot their packages, edit it, and then we do it live in the studio.
You'll have it.
Control to tape.
It's a little like more confined than just like field directing or directing anything else where you have time to put something together. I think it's just like any live show. It's putting all the different pieces and making them all fit in the time slot you have and making them as good as possible, which is super difficult because you have so many factors that go into it with the timing, with other people, with your talent, with the script, with the packages you're rolling in, the camera operators and all that stuff. There's nothing you can fix because it's all like happening in front of you and you have to make decisions as it happens. And that's the most difficult part is what is the right thing to do at that specific moment.
So if I adjust the clip way down and such and you know, green it up, you can see the back.
I mean, it's basically having everything organized and ready to go so that the director can show up, lead the team, and do their job today. And I think that's what's most important. I think Patrick's done a good job prepping everyone today. It seems like he had scripts out early and positions ready to go. So I think that's about the best that we can ask for.
Gabby, point there. We have whoever designed camera 3.
The floor director is the link between the director and the floor. They're the ones that interpret the director's, what the director is trying to accomplish for the talent and the guests and so on, as well as making sure that everyone is on set and where they need to be when they need to be there, and understands where they need to go and when they need to get there. So for example, if we have any guests on the show, the floor director is going to be likely going to be the one to make sure that they are where they need to be and that they're comfortable, as well as giving cues and making sure that the talent is understanding what's going on and where they need to be.
Getting ready to go to the in-building cosmetology department where they have barbershop.
Package producer has to create a story, so whether it be alumni or faculty or events or program of the week, they're creating a story. They find the topic, they research it, they get all the contacts, shoot it, edit it, all that good stuff, and get it ready for air.
No audio today.
The audio person has to come very early, make sure all the mics and the wires and the foldback and the IFB, and if I'm talking technical, how the communication between the floor and the control room. Make sure the director can talk to them. If they send music, they know there, if there's a feedback. Make sure all the mics are working, and that's pretty much about it.
What are you gonna be doing today?
Camera operator.
Camera operator needs to make sure they can get the host, the guests. They have to make sure they leave the proper lead room, proper headroom, stay in focus, and make sure you follow them, keep their reactions in frame. Otherwise, it'll look kind of weird if you cut off someone's head.
My job as prompter is just to like run, is to just like put script on copy, and the talent reads it from their cameras, basically. That's all it is.
So we back here, Michelle, that's it. And then it's the, what I do as the CG operator is cue up lower thirds and the graphics that are going to be in the show.
And my job as executive producer is just to make sure that all systems are go. So help, you know, create the set with them, find the host for them, make sure that, you know, everyone knows what they want to do, and make sure that we know the workflow of how to accomplish the vision. So it's a bunch of paperwork, a bunch of behind the scenes stuff, but eventually it gets us to the final show.
Tape is good, we're clear.
Hi guys, student producer Taylor Paget here, and this is another Hidden Gem KE. Tonight, we're going to take a ride on Milwaukee's infamous ghost train. Routed as the fastest passenger train in the world, the Chicago and Northwestern Railway's 400 routinely covered the 400 miles between Chicago and St. Paul, Minnesota in just under 400 minutes, including the travel through Shorewood along the route of today's Oak Leaf Trail.
This may look like a normal cross bridge, but it's actually an artistic sensory experience on the Oak Leaf Trail Bridge in Shorewood. The Ghost Train made its inaugural run on October 31st in 2016.
The first of its kind public art installation has enabled visitors to travel back in history, imagining the round-trip journey of the Twin Cities 400, which was operated by the Chicago and Northwestern Railway and crossed that same location from 1935 to 1963. You can catch the Ghost Train going northbound at 7 p.m. and southbound at 7:15 p.m. during the winter months, September 1st through March 31st. Every year on Halloween night, residents of Shorewood attend a celebration from 6:30 to 8 p.m. in the Corner Bakery parking lot in honor of the Night of the Ghost Train.
That's it for this week's Hidden Gem KE. Catch you on the Twin Cities 400.
MATC has a variety of programs and hands-on training for students. MATC Now student producer Kyle Melka and Wes Hawkins show you an interesting program that does just that. Let's check it out.
Nah, that was good.
Great. We shot it. Great.
Students in the welding program will graduate with high knowledge of many different types of welding techniques.
I'm in this program because I started, well actually in the summer, I wanted to build an electric go-kart and I needed to join the pieces. We have these really nice welders here. We get to work with other people. I've used other welders that I wouldn't be able to get my hands on, like TIG welding. I don't have that at all, so I enjoy all the machinery. The dangers of welding is having a spatter fall on your clothes and touch your skin, so I have a whole bunch right here from spattering. So that's one of the main dangers here. Other dangers are basically cutting yourself on all the grinding gear, burning yourself too, because when you weld the metal gets hot. And basically those are the three injuries that I've had here.
I heard about the welding program through my brother, so that really inspired me to start something new and make some more money. What I enjoy about this program is all the people that I've met and the skills that I've learned already, and that it's actually super fun.
A lot of people wonder, like, what is welding? Welding is actually taking two things and interlocking them together and then fusing and actually becoming one. Welding takes these atoms with, you know, different body structures depending on the carbon content or whatever, but it puts them together and fuses them together. So whatever you weld these two things together with, that has to be superior to the base metal. Because what it's doing is it's taking this base metal and this base metal and putting them together, but the weld itself has to be superior. It cannot be inferior or even as good. So what we do here is we'll weld, like, there's five basic joints: corner joint, lap joint, T joint, butt joint, and edge joint. We have them weld all those in the curriculum. because we want them to understand the positions, you know, if it's flat, horizontal, vertical, overhead position. We want them to understand everything to do with welding as far as positions and joints, processes. But once they get out in the real world, they're gonna weld bridges and all kinds of things like that. However, what we weld here is we weld the basic base metals. So we weld like A36 steel, you know, 308 stainless, and aluminum 40, 43, whatever the aluminum that we're welding. They don't understand that paper. They're not looking to be boxed in by a piece of paper. They want to build something. They want to create something. They want to put something together.
It takes a lot of patience because when I first started, I was super bad, but now I'm finally getting the hang of it. That's a great program, and if you haven't looked into anything yet, that this is a very good one to go into because weld's a very good trade, and there's so many job opportunities for it.
You have to like, you have to want it. You have to be a good welder, pretty much, like know what you're doing. This is like a really excellent program. I honestly thought when I first came in here, or when I like was gonna walk through here, I thought it wasn't gonna be, you know, very cool, but it actually exceeded my expectations. It's way cooler than I thought, so.
This is about 3/8. So you can tell you it's a lot more amps than that. Here we go.
I'm super excited because we have here on College Today student producer Val Halber's mother, Jenny. And Jenny's going to make your grandmother's classic, drumroll please, mac and cheese. From what I've heard, you have no problem bringing kids to your dinner table with this dish.
Oh, none at all.
Is it one of Val's favorite?
It always has been.
Okay. Yeah. Let's, since we have stuff prepared, why don't you tell us what you're doing?
Okay, sure. I started with the classic elbow macaroni noodles. And then I made a roux of melted butter and flour, 4 tablespoons each, to which I added 3 cups of milk already. Mm-hmm. And now I'm just stirring that up.
Is there spices in there at all?
I did. Oh, I added spice to it. I put a tablespoon of ground mustard, a teaspoon of onion powder, about a half a teaspoon of garlic powder. A lot of people don't like garlic powder in their mac and cheese. I do. A little bit of salt, same thing. A lot of people think there's enough salt with the cheese. I like a little extra. Mm-hmm. And then some black pepper.
Okay, cool.
And then this is 3 cups of dry noodles. And then, so a good way to remember that is 3 cups of noodles, 3 cups of milk, and then 3 cups of cheese.
Oh, it's all in even.
Yeah, so I don't really follow a recipe, but it's easy to remember that
yeah.
way.
Yeah, so all I'm, good cooks never follow recipes.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah. It's kind of the way I think of it. And then I'm gonna add my cheese to the roux and milk. I always use whole milk, it's just a little, you know, a little creamier.
Yeah.
I use extra sharp cheddar. You can use whatever cheese you like. A lot of people like Gruyere or even American cheese from the deli at the grocery store. That melts real nice. This, oh good, it's melting quickly. Should have the consistency of like a can of condensed soup once it's all melted. And this is such a nice and easy dish to make.
Yeah. And why did you specifically choose to show us this?
Mainly because it's easy. It's simple.
I'm all about easy cooking.
Yeah, it's quick. It's affordable. Let me turn this down a little bit.
Yeah.
It's, for the prep time is under 10 minutes. You can have this in the oven. And then it's 20 minutes later, it's on the table.
Yeah, that's thickening up pretty nice.
Yeah, that's great. I actually can take that off the heat now.
And why is this one of Val's favorite dishes?
I feel like, you know, most kids start with a box of Kraft mac and cheese when they're little, and it's kind of universally loved. And it just gets a little elevated from that.
Okay. And looks like that's set pretty nice, so let's put it in this little casserole dish
Grease a casserole dish. I use cooking spray. You can use butter or oil if you prefer.
Okay.
And
dump that all on there.
Just get
that. Make sure
that
it's
all
coated nice and even.
get it in, we'll stir it up.
Wonderful. And then why don't you tell us what's in the mixture that we put on top?
Oh yeah, here? I always do a topping. I got panko breadcrumbs, Parmesan cheese. I just use the Kraft grated, I guess it's Parmesan Romano blend. And
that's
then,
the easiest to buy, though.
Yep, and then melted butter. I think there's 4 tablespoons of melted butter. So this isn't, it's not a diet dish. It's not low-cal.
Totally fine. Okay, it looks like that's evenly coated. Let's put this on top and get it in the oven.
Sounds
because
good.
I'm hungry. So.
All right. We can just kind of shake that over the top.
All right, looks good enough.
All right.
Let's get that in the oven and take out our final product here.
Okay. And.
That looks so amazing. It looks smells like so that. Good too.
Thanks.
Normally my grandma puts saltines on top, so this looks very good and it's something I'm super excited to try. So I'm gonna take a little bit bite. Do you want some?
Yeah,
too?
For sure.
You made it, so you deserve it, right?
Yeah.
That is super good.
And this is Michelle Cross.
And we are here in
Las Vegas!
So it's pretty amazing to see all the sights and the lights. And it's pretty exciting to meet industry professionals, people from all sorts of fields, you know, the broadcast. And I'm really excited to see what's gonna happen.
This place is huge. Consider the world's largest convention center with almost 2 million square feet of exhibit space.
The NAB show hosts more than 100,000 people this year and more than 1,600 exhibitors that showcases the most amazing products.
The Sony experience has been
myself because I personally have used cameras almost all my life, but actually being able to talk one-on-one with so many people who have explored these cameras has allowed me to expand my own knowledge in the sense that, like, they're helping me troubleshoot things that I would have never even thought to troubleshoot and vice versa.
And we both got the chance to experience all this.
We invite the top film school and communication schools to bring the best of the best, and they learn from Sony using the equipment that their school has been using, whether it's broadcast cameras, switchers, servers, and they spend time here. And not only do they help Sony because they're an extension of our sales force, but they also get to learn.
It's truly remarkable. I've met some people from Frontline, somebody from a community college. I never thought I'd be able to say something like that. Sony has definitely opened up doors for me that I didn't know existed.
From YouTuber to high-end movie producer, NAB has something for everybody.
And don't worry if you couldn't make it this time. This convention is every year.
If you're thinking about it, do it.
Sierra Hernitz is an MATC graduate student in the TV and video production program. She also gets up really early to work for a local news station in Milwaukee.
For this morning show shift, I wake up at 3 o'clock in the morning and get to work and do the morning show, which I have to do live shots from 4:30 to 7, which is the morning show. And then I do a couple other video stops, we call them VOSOTs, but so I do a couple VOSOTs up until about 9 o'clock in the morning, and then I sit down in the studio and edit the noon show.
As almost every videographer, she started with still photography, but everything changed when she bought her first camcorder.
Pretty much started in high school. I've always liked moving picture and always thought it would be interesting to get behind the camera and see what happens, you know, for the production part of the show.
From all the options she had to develop her career, she chose MATC for a very specific reason.
But I looked more into MATC because I've heard that technical colleges give more hands-on work, and I'm not the type of person to sit in a desk and learn with notes. I have to have something in front of me, something to, you know, play with and do something with, and the description at MATC through their program kind of explained that. So, you know, it was a 2-year program, which it said, and I liked that it was short and also hands-on, and it proved that to me.
Her preparation at MATC has allowed her to overcome any adversity that has been presented at work.
Well, of course, every job that you start is gonna be a little nerve-wracking at first, which it was, but I did feel prepared coming into it. I didn't know what to expect initially, but once I got to work with the cameras, I was like, started going over stuff where I'm like, I remember that from school. So I took a lot of my knowledge and put it into the workspace that I have now. So it worked out.
Also, people who worked with her noticed that from the beginning.
I have worked with Sierra on and off the last year or so, summer of 2017 and now, and she's such a delight to work for. She gets it, and you can tell. And this job is hard, you know, and communication is so important. I come up with an idea and Sierra executes it. She's a photojournalist.
She also wants to send a message to the people who are currently studying at MATC in the TV production program.
Initially, when I started this program, I was like afraid. I was kind of timid and didn't want to, you know, interrupt anyone's lives. But for the program that we're in, you kind of have to get out there and talk to people and be social and, you know, pick people's brains that are in this industry, reporters or people that are doing this on a daily basis. So talk to people, pretty much network with people that are in the same business. Don't be afraid to shadow someone or talk to someone that's in the business. But yeah, if you're thinking about it, do it.
It's always powerful to see a college that truly cares about its students. And to speak on the importance of student engagement, we have Marissa Nicholson, the president of the student government for the downtown campus. How are you doing?
I'm doing great. How are you?
I'm doing pretty good.
That's good.
Why did you choose to go here to MITC?
Well, I grew up in Michigan, and around my eighth and ninth grade year, my mom brought me here to kind of look around to some schools to see where I wanted to go to further my education when I finished my senior year of high school. So we looked at Marquette, we looked at UWM, and we looked at MATC. I ended up going back home, kind of forgot all about it, and then when I graduated high school, I said, where am I going to go to college? So I ended up relocating to Wisconsin, still unsure of where I wanted to go. So I ended up taking a gap year off to kind of figure it out. And I met an advisor that year. And it was great because she helped me get into MATC. She helped explain what MATC has to offer and how I would fit into MATC. And it was great because she worked with me and helped me bring everything that I had from Michigan to Wisconsin.
That's great. So far, what student organizations have you participated in?
So far, I've been part of the Black Student Union on campus, as well as the campus ministries and veteran student organizations. This is my first year being the president of student government on campus.
Nice.
How did you get involved in student government here?
I really wanted to. In high school, we were very active. There was leadership present and things like that. And I thought that would be really great to bring that to MATC, to a college campus. I took everything that we kind of did in high school and I wanted to apply it to MATC. I met with some people and they said, hey, come join student government. And I was like, why not? This is perfect. This is what I want to do. And the ball rolled from there.
Can you tell us, for those who don't know, what student government does?
So student government is the body, the voice on campus. So we represent the students, which is very important because we, MATC's campus is a majority minority serving institution. So to have these different voices and have these different experiences in one room to represent such a diverse campus, it's great. So we advocate on behalf of the students. Some of our advocating includes going to Madison and talking to our senators and state reps, and we also do that on a national level, going to Washington, D.C. as well.
What part of those that do you find like most rewarding, that you're most excited about?
I think it's very rewarding to know that we actually have a voice and it's powerful. A lot of people think that we are students and that we are just students, but students actually have power, and to go and advocate on behalf of students and change laws and really get out there and so lawmakers know what we want, I think that's very rewarding.
Can you elaborate on that a little bit?
So some of the laws, we've worked on the Higher Education Act, and also something that we've been really heavily involved in is the DACA, as we know that it's expired. So we have a lot of, since I mentioned that we have a diverse campus, we have a lot of students who have immigrated. So that's been a big issue that we brought up as well.
Wow, that's amazing.
How did you come about being the president of student government?
So I saw that student government, it was going through a transition period. And I thought that I would be great. I thought I had a lot to offer the students. And I said, let's see. So I went to a meeting, and next thing you know, I got elected, and I was like, okay, it's really happening, but I will gladly accept the nomination. And I ran for it, and I was selected and elected, and I'm here today.
That's awesome.
I really want to know more about how student government is helping with DACA.
So we've gone to Washington, D.C., and express our concerns. So what they really need to know is that we can talk about it at school and we can talk about it on a local level, but if we don't go to our state reps and talk to them and express these concerns, because DACA is helping people who have been in the United States for a certain amount of time to get their education. and it's being revoked. So we have gone there, we've expressed our concerns. We actually brought a student who is receiving DACA benefits who will be cut off from that, so.
Any last brief things you want to say to people who want to get involved in student government?
I think it's a really great thing to get involved with because we are a family. We have each other's back, and it's wonderful.
Thank you so much for talking with us today. I'm so amazed seeing all the things that student government does here.
Hey there, everyone. Student producer Elias Bailey here with another Hidden Gem KE.
This 74-foot-tall lighthouse on Wall Avenue along the lakeside has been part of Milwaukee since 1855. The original lighthouse was much smaller and closer to the shore until 1887 when the present lighthouse was built in its current location.
The lighthouse and grounds were maintained by lighthouse keepers, and later on, the United States Coast Guard, until October 13, 2003, when the United States Coast Guard handed ownership over to Milwaukee County, making this gem permanent part of Lake Park.
Between 1836 and 1850, Wisconsin's population increased from a mere 11,000 in 1836 to over 305,000 by 1850, all of this due to immigration.
This lighthouse was the first thing the immigrants saw when they entered the new land they would soon call home. This lighthouse serves as both a beacon of change and a symbol of Milwaukee's upbringing. The lighthouse is open to the public every Saturday and Sunday. Schedule a tour and learn more about what makes this a great gem.
Unfortunately though, that is all the time we have for today. I'm student producer Elias Bailey, and this has been another Hidden Gem KE. I'm gonna keep looking around.
I'm student producer Nick Feeling, and this is another Hidden Gem KE. The Oak Leaf Trail is a hidden gem within Milwaukee's woods.
It all started in 1939 by bike advocate Harold Zip Morgan, who envisioned the first 64 miles of the trail from Milwaukee to Menominee.
It wasn't until 1965 that the Milwaukee County Parks recognized the trail and took it over.
Since then, the trail's expanded to over 125 miles with 7 different lines that connects 19 different municipalities. Today, the trail gives residents a place to escape into nature as well as a safe place to exercise.
I'm student producer Nick Feeling, and this has been your Hidden Gem KE.
Hi everyone, student producer Gabrielle Nasby here, and this is a Hidden Gem KE.
Today, we are here at Three Bridges Park. This park features a 2-mile walking trail, river access for fishing, canoeing, and many different community gardens.
This park opened in the summer of 2013 and is located between 27th and 37th Street, a 24-acre oasis urban in the Menominee River Valley.
Back in the 1960s, this particular area used to be filled with more man-made barriers like train tracks and freeways before the area got redesigned to a better area where the community can get together. The park is connected with the Menominee River Valley that has a rich narrative of bridging the past to the future, north to south, and it is located between the Potawatomi Hotel Casinos and the Mitchell Park Conservatory.
Well, that's all the time we have for this episode. I'm Gabrielle Nasby, and this has been your Hidden Gem KE. I'm gonna go for a walk.
Every week, the guided pathways show ways for students to get the kind of help that they need to get through the school year. Student producer Austin Gunderson has this to show you.
November 8th is the soft opening for the Guided Pathways program. And today, we talked to some of the team members who are helping to get it off the ground.
So the training is, it's about 6 weeks. We're in like week four, almost. The training is going really well. We're getting to know each other as a team. And I think it's really helping us prepare for November 8th. Yeah, for our soft open, so to speak.
What are some obstacles that the current MATC students in the program face?
Well, right now, we are like a cafeteria college. So what we're trying to do is provide this more student-focused approach where it has individualized experience, where we're aware of students and their problems that they face while they're trying to go through their education. And we're gonna fill in those gaps and give them that one-on-one assistance to help lead them the right direction.
Moving forward, what will the model look like?
I would say the model would look like a place where students feel welcomed, students feel engaged, students feel empowered, students will feel enriched. It just wouldn't be a place where you walk in and walk out. You'll feel like you're a part of something.
I think one faculty member mentioned something about their student personality, like some students like to collaborate with others. There might be some students that work better alone. So maybe someone wants to register in a program, but they don't know where to fit in.
What would you like them to know to get them accustomed and acclimated to this new program?
Well, most importantly, I want them to know that we are here for you. We are welcoming with the open arms, and our doors are open. So when November 8th comes around, please don't hesitate to come see us. We want them to be heroes in their own stories and be successful on that road to graduation.
I'm Michael Brooks. I've been making pizzas in Milwaukee for close to a decade. New York and Chicago pizza is always talked about. I'm here to look at the pizza I know the most about, Milwaukee pizza. Let's take a look at two pizza places that have been around the longest and one that's relatively new. This is Pizza Pies and Pepperoni.
Welcome to Pizza Pies and Pepperoni. We're here to discuss Milwaukee pizza. What is it, who has it, and how it came to be. In the studio to join our pizza discussion is Lori Frederick. Lori is the senior food and dining writer for onmilwaukee.com, author of Milwaukee Food, A History of Cream City Cuisine, and co-host of Food Crush Podcast. Lori, thanks for joining us today.
Thanks for having me, Mike.
So what kind of research went into writing a book like Milwaukee Food, A History of Cream City Cuisine?
You know, I wrote the book because I decided that we really, there was nothing written about the history of Milwaukee dining, and we really needed something that kind of laid out the land and told people that, yes, we do have a thriving, wonderful food scene. So I spent about half of my time going through the archives, old newspapers, and all that to really pull together the history of Milwaukee dining from the founding of Milwaukee, kind of up to about the 1970s and 80s. And then from there, I profiled some of the restaurants that are on the scene now, a lot of the chef-owned restaurants that make up the scene. And basically, like the modern history, traces the city from kind of its beginnings, which I would say was with Sanford and Sandy D'Amato and Ristorante Bartolotta, to the Bartolottas, kind of all the way up to more recent times when we have restaurants like Ardent, Good Kind, and so forth.
Well, between that and writing at On Milwaukee, saying you're well-versed in Milwaukee dining would be an understatement. Let's get right into it and discuss this topic. Pizza in America goes back to 1905. It's attributed to Lombardi's in New York, who still serves pizza today. When did pizza find its way to Milwaukee, and who was the first to serve it?
So it's interesting because once pizza came to New York, it took a little while to get to the Midwest. Mm-hmm. And if you trace the history of pizza, it kind of spread to the surrounding areas around New York, like New Jersey, and that first. Made it to Chicago around 1938, and to the West Coast in 1938 or 39. But it made it to Milwaukee and cities like Detroit and St. Louis in like the mid-1940s. And the first place to serve pizza in Milwaukee was the Caradero Club, which was actually on Erie Street in the Third Ward. That was part of Milwaukee's big Italian community. That location eventually burned down. Mm-hmm. But in the years that they were there, they were the first to serve pizza. Interestingly, nobody knew what pizza was.
It didn't really take off, did it?
And they didn't start serving pizza. They served Italian dishes, lasagna, pasta, and things. Mm-hmm. And because people didn't know what pizza was, they couldn't sell it at first. So they actually gave it away.
Slice by slice, downtown,
to people until people were like, "Oh, that's really good." Hard to believe,
yeah, right.
At this point, right? So, and from there, pizza spread. There were other places that cropped up, kind of in the Third Ward, like closer to the 1950s. Okay. But I think you know some secrets about maybe who was second. Yeah.
Well, with that history in mind, let's take a look at a Milwaukee pizza place that's in its third generation of family ownership. Found on a quiet street in Bayview, it's Di Marini's Pizza.
Welcome to Di Marini's.
Di Marini's Pizza, a Milwaukee pizza institution, can be seen from the Bayview end of the Home Bridge. Second-generation owner Phil Di Marini's was here from the beginning.
In 1952, the pizzas in Milwaukee started coming up from Chicago. It was a big thing. My dad said, you know, my brother and I were young kids, said that we had to get involved. Well, we had to work in the kitchen. At that time, we had to punch the dough to knead it and everything else. As little kids, we stood on crates, and when they would cut the sausage, our job was to turn the crank. If we sold at that time, 2-3 pizzas in a night, that was phenomenal.
Finally recalling the old days, Phil remembers the first pizza place in the city and discusses one of the keys to DeMarina's Pizza's longevity.
We were actually the second one to be in business. And the first one was Club Caradero. It was on the east side at the time. And a gentleman, Murphy Ermey, would come in by us, because he was a bartender down there, and talk about, oh, we sold 520 pizzas. And we'd go, that's impossible, because we were baking them in a regular oven before we got the 3-stack ovens. As the business went on, we had to buy machinery. But we were the second ones to follow, and we're still in existence. We go back generations with our customers, that their children's children now have families, and they come to us, which is very important for the existence of DeMarina's.
This is our stop. You know, you can't beat the food, the drinks, the camaraderie. It's so great.
Many years we lived down in this area. Nowadays we live out in the Muskego area, and we still come back here almost every week, at least once if not twice, because the pizza's fantastic, the ambience, the friendship, camaraderie, the service, everything is just phenomenal.
The people that work for us have been with us for years and years, and we're very fortunate that way, you know. Sandy over there, she's been with us 18 years. Al's been with us 55 years.
I mean, I've known him my whole life. We used to cut 1,000 pounds of pork butt on Tuesday, 6 of us, make sausage, and then another 1,000 pounds on Thursday.
Growing up making pizza, Phil is glad to not only have one of the longest running pizza places in the city, but one that's stayed in the family.
Our name is, you know, attached with pizza. You know, anywhere you go, you say our last name and they go, oh, pizza, you know. And that's the same now with my daughters, who are the third generation, and that. And they basically run this place, and that. My wife works here on Saturday nights as a hostess. We believe in keeping it a family operation.
Phil was gracious enough to give us a look behind the scenes.
As you see the pans there, these pans here are the originals. People, they come in and they say, you know, how come your pans are bent? I said, because they're original, and that I didn't want to get rid of them. And that people know when they come here that they're getting what started in 1952. You see they're putting the sausage on, and that. And that's our recipe also. The dough is our recipe, and the sausage is our recipe, and the tomato sauce also.
Phil leaves us with one last secret to the success of DeMarina's Pizza.
Our customers mean the world to us. We literally love our customers. They're not a number, they're a person. And they walk through the door, we know who they are. If not, we get to know them.
I didn't know they were the second pizza place in Milwaukee. Now that we've seen what their pizza looks like, let's talk about Milwaukee style. Some claim that Milwaukee has a distinct style of pizza, but is that really true? Let's settle this debate.
Let's settle it, indeed. People like to argue about pizza, and especially people from Chicago like to say that Milwaukee does not have its own style of pizza, partially because Milwaukee-style pizza, or the pizza that we have claimed as our own. It's a thin crust pizza, you know, round, thin, crackery crust that really holds up. It's resilient. It'll hold a lot of toppings. Yeah. And it's typically cut tavern style into squares, yeah. Or party style, mm-hmm. What some people call it. And that does sound a lot like Chicago tavern style pizza. But the reality is, you know, we've talked about the groundings of pizza here. We've talked about how the first pizza was at the Caradero Club, and that was that crust. Yeah. In fact, I think that original crust, that thin, crispy, like crackery crust, was the foundation of Milwaukee Pizza. And that crust actually spread. You know, folks from Zaffiro's worked at Caradaro Club, Balestrieri's worked at Caradaro Club.
Yep.
And all of those iconic places that kind of formed the foundations for what people think of as the best pizza in Milwaukee right now, all of those have the same crust. So I say we can lay claim, you know, to that.
What would be the topping choice then for Milwaukee style?
And then there's the toppings, yep. Because you can't come to Milwaukee or be, you know, a true Milwaukeean without ordering at least once that cheese, sausage, mushroom, and onion combination. Because that is classic.
It's the standard Milwaukee pizza.
So.
But also, frozen pizza came from Wisconsin.
Frozen pizza has origins. I actually did, you know, I looked at this a little bit. It's got origins in the Midwest. They say that the first nationally distributed frozen pizza was actually in Minnesota. Oh,
okay.
But Milwaukee became a central point for the manufacturing of frozen pizza. And you can see that now. I mean, we have big manufacturers like Palermo's right here.
And then there's smaller ones too.
And smaller ones all over the place. So frozen pizza kind of found its home here.
That's cool. What else we're going to move on. When people discuss Milwaukee-style pizza, the next place we visited is always in the conversation. When you're done with your pizza, you can always go across 27th Street and visit another Milwaukee legend, Leon's Custard. This is Ned's Pizza.
Ned's Pizza has been serving pizza since 1969. Owner Bob Meyer was there in the beginning.
Well, we've been here for 51 years now. Grade school friend Don Strack and I were looking for something to do after getting out of the Army back in the 60s. We knew a guy that was in the business, and we worked for him as teenagers and delivery guys and short order cooks and stuff. And then we were introduced to Ned Hewitt, who had a pizza operation on Villard Avenue, on 32nd and Villard, which was one of the earliest ones that was started in Milwaukee. We signed an agreement with him we envisioned opening a lot of stores, but that never came to fruition. But Ned had three other stores at one time, including ours, so we had the city pretty well covered. Our Hobart mixer's about 60 years old and still going away, grinding away like crazy. Utilized every day for some heavy duty stuff.
Bob's daughter, Leanne, is the second generation of ownership. Leanne believes that Ned's has stood the test of time because of their employees.
We have, I believe, 8 employees who worked here or are still currently working for over 40 years. And then we have, I think, 14 employees who've been here 20 to 30 plus years.
Scott Stoles started working at Ned's when he was 14. Scott knows that one of the keys to dough making is experience.
I usually train everybody who walks through the front door on dough because, you know, the two main ingredients that I believe that make a pizza are the crust and the sauce.
We start with a 50-pound bag of flour. We use a certain type of flour.
We obviously have your various normal ingredients for dough. You have salt, yeast, sugar. Our dough recipe varies. We use a certain amount of water in the winter months compared to the summer months. In the summer, we use a little bit less water. There's more moisture in the air. Whereas days like today, where it's only 15 degrees out, we have to use more water. As you can see, I have 3 buckets prepared with liners. It gets cut up and proportionally distributed into 3 buckets and then goes into our walk-in cooler or a process to where it begins to rise. It takes 15 to 18 hours to rise and then where it becomes cold, and then we have to bring it back out to where you see dough here to where it comes to room temperature. That way it's usable and pliable to go through our mixer in the front.
Moving to the kitchen where Rolly Bloom has been cooking pizza at Ned's since 1973, we see how to make a Ned's pizza.
Okay, I'm gonna start by rolling out 2 crusts here for us. Here we just flour them up a little bit, run them through one chute, through the second, And then down through a third chute, we use as a template to make the size of the pizza what we want, which are gonna be two 14-inch pizzas. And then we can come over to our making table, which here, just flip it to make sure that it doesn't stick. And then we'll dock it up and sauce it. This first one I'll make here is one of Milwaukee's most popular with cheese, sausage, mushroom, and onion. All mozzarella, 100%, yep. From Wisconsin, we use all mainly local ingredients from the Milwaukee area and throughout Wisconsin. So then this pizza is done, we'll just give it a little shake here and we'll slide it up into the ovens here and let her start baking.
Leanne leaves us with one last thought about the family business.
I used to have a career in advertising, and my dad had sort of started talking about retiring, and that's what brought me back to Milwaukee, is that I didn't want the business to leave our family. And when I say our family, I don't mean just me, my dad, and my mom. I mean our Ned's family, which is all the employees who've been here for so long. So it means a great deal to me. The people I work with every day have seen me grow up. And, you know, it's like a family here. So it means a lot to me that we can continue the tradition that Bob and Don started in 1969.
If you've ever been to Ned's on a weekend, you know the love that Milwaukee has for them. Ned's is another great example of a classic Milwaukee pizza. The old school tavern style pizzas have stood the test of time in Milwaukee. Recently, we've been seeing some different styles pop up. What kind of new places have you noticed, Lori?
You know, you can pretty much get any style of pizza that you want in Milwaukee now. From New York style to Chicago deep dish, to like hand-tossed kind of thicker crust, and Milwaukee has got its own kind of style of deep dish pizza. And every now and again, you can find Detroit style pizza at the Tandem.
That's right.
Caitlin Cullen has some background in Detroit, so nice. She brought that with her. In addition to that, we also have one of the only restaurants in Wisconsin to be certified Neapolitan pizza. Certified by the VPN, which is the presiding authority that basically guides the making of Neapolitan style pizza across the world.
Yeah.
From the 00 flour that they use to the tomatoes they use. And it's a really rigorous certification process where all of the chefs have to go through the training. And you have to do it right every single time.
It's always wood fire.
Yes.
We got multiple wood fire pizza joints too. Still.
We do.
Milwaukee.
We do.
We got Anodyne,
I think you mentioned that
Santino's.
One of your favorites is Anodyne. Yeah. Santino's Little Italy.
Yep.
There's Y East Pizza on the west side.
Yeah.
So good
and
stuff.
And we got some new ones popping up too. We got Flower Child coming up soon.
Yep. And Flower Child is going to take all the good pizzas from New Haven style, which is kind of coal fired crust, to New York and Detroit. And they're going to roll it all into one and then put some really, really great inventive vegetarian toppings on them.
Well, this next place has been around for almost 15 years, enough time to be pizza veterans, but still considered the new guys, as far as old school Milwaukee pizza is concerned. For a different look at Milwaukee pizza, we visited a Bayview staple, Classic Slice.
Classic Slice has been in business for almost 15 years. Relatively new in Milwaukee's old school history, owner Jason Spigorski recalls where the idea for Classic Slice came from.
Marissa, my partner, she started Classic Slice. She wanted to do a fresh ingredient, quality ingredient spot that was fast casual. I usually call it American pizza. So it doesn't lean into Neapolitan. I guess it's easy to talk about what it's not, but it's based loosely around New York style pizza. But what we do is a little bit different. New York style pizza is generally a reheat single slice, thing, and we do it slightly differently from New York style because this is Milwaukee, and because we don't have Manhattan foot traffic, so we don't do the fast process. We do a more slightly slower process to accommodate the rate of Milwaukee business and Milwaukee life.
Jason helps define the idea of Milwaukee-style pizza and where classic slice fits in.
It is a very crispy, very thin, and I think one of the defining characteristics of Milwaukee pizza is that Milwaukee people like to have a lot of toppings on their pizza. Four toppings, five toppings, six toppings, that's kind of a staple, like what we call the deluxe or the supreme. Those are all five topping, six topping canned vegetable pizzas, which is sausage, mushroom, onion, pepperoni, black olives, green peppers, right? So that's kind of like, so many people come into Classic Slice to order those things. We do a lot of specialties that are high topping ingredients or high quantity ingredients that are different, but kind of skew still towards that. It's like your whole leftover Thanksgiving dinner on top of a pizza, which a lot of people in America scoff at. A lot of people are purists, like the Neapolitan style is generally three toppings, two toppings, sometimes no toppings. So we kind of just try to embrace both sides of it, but the Milwaukee, like how we fit into that is sort of bringing like a fresh ingredient take on the kitchen sink Milwaukee style. And we don't do the crispy cracker, we're a hand-tossed place. The foundation of our pizza is a lot different, but the sentiment I think is there. We even have the vegan MKE, or the vegan Milwaukee, which is a sausage mushroom onion with vegan cheese and vegan sausage. So we totally like try to pay tribute to what the Milwaukee, the old school Milwaukee pizza mindset is like.
Part of Classic Slice's success is their diligence in using high quality ingredients.
A lot of pizzerias use Wisconsin cheese, ones that aren't in Wisconsin. So it's sort of like a no-brainer to use local cheese because it's made at Grande, which is in central Wisconsin. So that's easy, but we then do use some imported other cheeses, but the flour and the tomatoes we use for the sauce are also American-made. We don't import those. We feel like California tomatoes are great. And I have a brand that I use that has no preservatives added. And I like that we use American flour.
Jason saw a need for vegan options and looked to cater to a then overlooked part of the population.
In 2007, that did not exist in pizza in Milwaukee, as far as I know. So we started developing that side of it, and I've really pushed. There's also a group called Vegan Milwaukee, and a few other groups that really like did specific events here and supported us a lot because we were supporting them. So we started developing our own products, our own vegan soy cheese, our own vegan sausage, and different pies that would utilize those things. Things that skew to what a vegan diet craves. Pizza is a communal food. It's something that everyone's an expert on. They're an expert on their own tastes. So you have to put things out there and people will tell you what they like. People will tell you what they don't like. You just try to provide a good version of that, or the best version of that you can.
We're not only seeing changes in Milwaukee's pizza spots, but in Milwaukee dining overall. It seems like it's an exciting time to be a food and dining writer. How have you seen the city's food scenes change over the last handful of years?
It is definitely a good time to be a food and dining writer, but it's an even better time to be an eater.
Oh yeah.
Because Milwaukee, like if you had gone away maybe 10 years ago and you came back to Milwaukee today, you would hardly recognize in terms of the dining scene. You wouldn't believe how many places we have. You know, from higher end places like Ardent on the east side to, you know, really comfortable but great food at like places like Good Kind in Bayview, Bivette, you know, woman-owned butcher shop and cafe serving higher-end food on the Third Ward.
Downtown or in Third Ward, all that.
And really a lot of diversity, global cuisines, the whole nine yards. Yeah. Love it in Milwaukee.
Well, as we wrap up, Lori, we forgot to ask one very important question. What's your favorite pizza?
That's a terrible question. Impossible to answer. But I have a real appreciation for the pizza at Y Yeast. They use a long fermented dough. It's delicious. Nothing like it.
Well, thanks so much for joining us today, Lori. We appreciated your insight.
Thanks, Mike.
Well, until next time, I'm Michael Brooks, and this has been Pizza Pies and Pepperoni. Thanks for watching.
Mine is the cheese and sausage with a little extra sauce, light on the onion. My wife makes me put pepperoni on it, and you put the pepperoni on top because it gets nice and crispy, and she likes the black olive, so that's my second, but I tell her it's okay.
I usually eat a junior 10-inch of cheese, sausage, onions, green peppers, and pepperoni on top with extra sauce.
You're feeding people, and that's what's important. It's quality and sincerity.
My favorite pizza, one we have almost every day to test, to make sure that our recipes are correct and stuff, is what we call our combo, and that's cheese, sausage, and pepperoni.
It's probably tied for favorite would be the triple P, which is a little unique. Well, it's unique to us. It's spicy, and it has pepperoni, pickles, and pepperoncini peppers.